Welcome back, International Rugby Classic, presented by Astellas. Australia, number two in the world, leading 14-10 over the USA Eagles. The USA has never beaten Australia. This would be the biggest win in the program history. Kenny Rice, along with former USA team captain Brian Hightower, we welcome you back in on what has been a warm, muggy summer night, and it's heated up in here as the fans believing that the U.S. may have a chance as they came in a big underdog as we start the second half.
Well, the United States just has to keep their composure. We said at the very beginning of this game, Kenny, keep that mental edge through 80 minutes. And you wonder if the seeds of doubt have started to be sown a little bit in the heads of the Australian players.
Aussies trying to spread it out. Some good tackling early on by the United States. We saw throughout that first half. And once again, Palamo right there to bring down a Wallaby.
And Palamo's been huge in the midfield for the Eagles. Lots of guys stepping up, making hits. It's been a great collective team effort on defense. It's got to be maintained through the next 40, though.
And for the United States, biggest win in the history of this program to knock off the number two team? I asked the question. Most people think this would be the biggest win.
Absolutely. Not even most people. Everybody knows that this would be an absolutely unprecedented victory for the United States. The United States has never beaten what is known as a tier one country in rugby, Kenny. So any of the top 10 countries, top five, top six especially, certainly not at number two.
Over 25,000 fans on hand tonight at Soldier Field, one of the largest crowds to ever watch USA rugby.
A lot of unforced errors from the Wallabies, a lot of knock-ons. Now, some of those are coming because of the shoulders of the American tacklers, but if I'm Michael Checa, I wonder about that halftime discussion. He's usually a pretty mild-mannered, philosophical bloke, but he's got to be a little bit worried about the performance of this Wallaby team.
Line out controlled by Team USA, and Gwenya, who had a great assist for the last try. Now with the ball is Palamo, who's made some great hits, as we've already seen throughout this game.
Tough to tackle, and Palamo almost got that leg free for a breakaway. McGinty goes to the air. He's got Blaine Scully.
Scully giving chase. Getting the ball, though, is Bernard Foley, number 10 for Australia.
Blaine Scully, kind of his bread and butter, his ability under the high ball, but that one just doesn't hang up long enough for him.
And he'll kick that into touch. We know one famous Australian, an Academy Award winner, and quite a rugby player himself, I understand, watching, Russell Crowe. With a shout out to another famous Aussie, Hugh Jackman. Yes, the Wallabies are playing right now at Soldier Field. They're having to play a tough game against the Americans. I added that last part.
I tell you what, if you're an Australian rugby fan, you got to be a little bit nervous right now the way these Eagles are coming at the Wallabies.
Well, as we know, with any athletic contest, sometimes when a team comes in as a big favorite, you say, oh, just how much hype is it when they say we're not taking anything for granted? But Australia said that. Said, look at USA. They won three straight against Canada. They're playing with a lot of confidence. They're at home. We're not taking it for granted. It's showing now with the way that the Americans have played.
Offside, over 15, number 9.
What a penalty against Australia. That's Nick Phipps being called for the penalty. The U.S., you can tell just the way they're carrying themselves. A lot of composure.
Now you take a look at number 9, Mike Petrie, who had a try, the last try for the U.S., out of Brooklyn, New York, played at Penn State.
Looks like John Quill, wearing the number 20 for the United States, has come on to start the second half.
Quill, another sizable body at around 240. There's number 10, Bernard Foley. Foley just getting a 3-year contract extension on his professional career.
That's a great kick downfield. The United States, they're just moving confidently. There's nothing panicky about the way they are. We mentioned that first 5 minutes, how they got themselves under a little bit of pressure, but now they're banging on the door on the Australian end. Great execution. There's John Quill in the air. Can the U.S. make something from this 5-meter line? It's been a big problem from these Eagles, and already we see the knock-on by the U.S. down at their 5-meter line. And Kenny, if there's been any Achilles heel for this Eagle team, it's been how to create points, especially tries from the 5-meter line when you're knocking on your opponent's door. And so many times they've worked their way down to receive nothing. It is absolutely frustrating. And now the Wallabies with the put in.
Shoulder side.
Number 9, Phipps with the ball.
Shoulder back. 5, 6.
Good scrum by the Wallabies. A penalty advantage being played.
Left.
Australia with it. Holding on to that 14-10 lead. 45 minutes plus being played into this. Nick Phipps been a big part of this team tonight. Kicked into touch. There you see a happy Wallaby fan. Several of them staying in the area. We saw them at the hotel cheering on their team. Some came with the team last week. The Wallabies came over to Chicago on Wednesday, but they are very accustomed to the Midwest. Last week, they were on the Notre Dame campus, spent the week there training, came to Chicago here about the 95-mile drive on Wednesday, and then next week they plan on going back to South Bend and train some more before they go on to London for the World Cup.
And they absolutely love it on that South Bend campus. In fact, the players tell you, they are all wearing Irish kit now, the Fighting Irish hats, the jerseys, and some of them actually said they're going to get a chance to put pads on next week and see what that feels like. That'll be interesting.
Trying to drive the ball one more time. They have not been able to outmuscle the U.S. throughout today.
Sean McMahon with the break.
McMahon stopped. They'll try the other way. Hanging on to it. Nice little pass inside by Foley. They try the direction up the middle. United States, then 5 meters of a try, and then they turn it over to the Australians. What a huge turn it would be if the Aussies can put 5 more points on the board. And it's one of those where they can't afford to make mistakes like that against a team like this. And there's the takeaway. Taking the ball away is McGinty.
Comes on a screaming defensive line, puts pressure.
There's another look at it. You see 14, and Guinea has made some big plays tonight, and then McGinty coming in and ripping it away, the former Life University star.
But a long advantage being played by the referee, and so it'll be a penalty to Australia. Here's Giddo. He'll kick to the corner. Energetically, Kenny, game seems to have taken a little bit of a lull, and it wouldn't have been that way if the United States could have capitalized. The lineout is one of their strengths, and they had the ball in the air, and it looked like when John Quill went up, caught the ball, he just wasn't able to hold on to it. The United States squanders it, and look, we're 95 meters away from where the United States was.
The total opposite end. Now with it is Douglas, number 4. They're trying to bully their way in, getting close to the try. Did they get it in there? It looks like they have.
They did. That's Sean
McMahon.
And they did.
It is McMahon.
Wearing 7. The youngster, former 7s player for the Wallabies.
Rookie of the year at Super Rugby last year, a breakout season, and there he is, the 21-year-old, 225 pounds.
Well, this is just the Australians exerting their pack dominance. The U.S. so hard to stop that rolling ball.
And what a turnaround. The U.S. within 2 meters of taking the lead and driving it all the way to the other end and scoring as Australia to up it once again by 9.
Just like that. And it's really a combination of errors. First, the knock on from the line out, and then the scrum and a penalty in the scrum. yields the kick. The kick yields another line out, more possession, and another penalty, kick to the corner, and just like that, the Wallabies march it 100 meters away from what was U.S. pay dirt.
A huge turn of events. Foley to kick. On its way and through. So what could have been a 17-14 lead for the U.S. After the turnover, it's now the Australians increasing their lead to 21-10.
And for the Americans, this is about staying on the job. And you wonder if the Wallabies are waking up. Sometimes a team can just flip the switch. They can have a look with each other, just eye contact in a little huddle, and basically decide to change the shape of a game. And you wonder if the Wallabies are capable of doing that against the Eagles, or can the U.S. continue to bring their shoulders, cause turnovers? There's Will Guinea. He's come in to replace Nick Phipps at halfback.
Guinea, number 22, one of the stalwarts on this team. Douglas has it right now, brought down with an ankle tackle. A nice one by the captain, Wiles. They get it out to the middle of the field. Peloto now hasn't carried much, gets it there. And now they'll kick.
Box kick by Guinea inside the 22-meter. Chris Wiles, U.S. captain, calls for the mark, and he'll get it.
There's a look at Wiles, born in Stamford, Connecticut. Spent a lot of his youth at Allentown, Pennsylvania. His family moved to England. Of course, that's where he got into the game of rugby. And he is the captain of this team. And that one is high, way into the stands. The turnover for the U.S. so big early in this second half.
Finoglio, he hits his target. There's John Quill, but then just nobody to catch that ball. Everybody's focusing on the drive, and Quill is handing the ball down so that the U.S. can start their rolling ball. And unfortunately, the ball goes forward instead of in the safe hands of one of those forwards. That's just a communication thing.
And Quill in for the first time in this game here in the second half.
Yeah, and I don't think that's John Quill's fault. He's just laying the ball out, and it looks like somebody missed an assignment. Somebody's supposed to have their hands on that ball.
And the lineup. Here comes Quade Cooper. Now in the lineup, number 21 for Australia. Best check in now, see what's happening on the pitch, and go down to Tracy Wilson.
Well, guys, it was interesting in practice yesterday talking to Michael Cheka. And I was with the Australian media who were talking about this as a little warm-up game. And he said, absolutely not. He said, our World Cup starts with this game against the Eagles. He was not taking this team lightly, and neither were his players. They, to a man, talked about the physicality of the U.S. players, and that certainly has been a factor at this point.
Thank you, Tracy. And now mentally, how will the U.S. be able to hang in here after having a great opportunity blown, and instead it turned into 7 more points for the Australians? Aussie's trying to drive straight ahead. Looking outside and getting across the halfway mark into U.S. territory once again. Nice little inside pass by Foley.
Seems like a little bit more urgency at the breakdown. U.S.
And you're watching live from Soldier Field in Chicago. So many great events over the years. And this is the International Rugby Classic presented by Astellas. Glad that you're with us. Kenny Rice, former U.S. captain, Brian Hightower, and Tracy Wilson on the sideline. Australia, number 2 in the world, coming in after a big win against number 1 New Zealand. They're a huge favorite over Team USA, but the Americans playing tough, trailing by only 4 going into the second half. And then Australia able to take advantage of a U.S. turnover and put 7 more on the board. So that's where we are right now at the 53-47 mark of this match.
Earlier, Kenny, we talked about staying mentally in this. And mentality and fitness are linked so closely together. If you don't that switch on mentally, and if your fitness isn't there, you start to commit penalties. You just don't retreat as fast across the offside line. You make bad decisions in the breakdown area. You can't keep your feet as much, and that starts to wear on you, and penalties start to accrue. And you wonder if that's what's happening with these Eagles.
And once again, Australia threatening with another score, a score that would widen the margin, and you wonder if it would just deflate these United States players after playing so hard, and they get in, and they get the try.
And that's Dean Mum, who's come in as a replacement at lock. And Mum just gets a nice little flip from Guinea. Take a look here, just one off the side.
Two men just in the lineup, Guinea and Mum here in the second half. Two veteran players for them too, by the way.
Yeah, and that's a mismatch. You got Mike Petrie against Dean Mum. And physically, that's just one that's going to yield a little bit of going backwards for Petrie. But, you know, the spacing of these players, they're starting to eat up more resources. And it's simple math, Kenny. If you can devote less resources to win a ball, and the other team has to devote more resources in terms of personnel to the ball, there's going to be a mismatch somewhere. There's going to be space. And the experience of these Australians, they look up, they have a feel for the space. That comes with playing the game since they're 5 years old. It comes from the repetition of the hostile, high-pressure environment from the super professional rugby that they play.
And Mum, all 6'4", 240 pounds, a 31-year-old, taking it in. And the Australians now 26-10. And trying to add to it is Foley, and he does. Two more points off the foot of Bernard Foley. And now what was a 14-10 game to start this second half, Australia now opening it up.
Well, that's, you know, Dean Mum could practically lean across from 5 meters out. The Australians maybe starting to get their swagger back, maybe some questions at halftime, but it looks like their confidence is back. U.S. really needs to continue to step up. Now, look, we talked to these guys all week, and Kenny, what they said was, look, it's not about a win. It is about continuing to be process-oriented on the field, to compete at every breakdown, and to be able to play their pattern. And they've been able to do that to a degree. Consistency, an issue. We'll see if fitness in the last 20 minutes is an issue as well.
And with a nice tackle there is Danny Barrett, number 21. They kick it away. Now moving with it for the U.S. is Blaine Scully. And they'll try to get something going. And really, at this stage, they need to get something going, it would seem, Brian, just if nothing else, just to kind of lift their spirits a little bit after coming so close.
Well, you know, you got to keep this a ball game. And, you know, another try for the Australians, and it'll start to look like it's a sealed deal. But you got to stay on the job. And we'll see the difference between these Eagles and the Eagles from last November against the All Blacks. If they stay in the game, if they can put more points on the board.
And they'll boot it away. Kicking it high is Petrie.
James Kelly's there first. And number 16, Phil Teal, has checked in. He's playing hooker now. Zach Finolio takes a seat on the bench, puts the warm-ups on.
Goes back deep, number 10. That's McGinty. He gets it, fires it right back. And that goes way into touch, into the stands once again.
A little bit humid out there. Boys losing some fluids, and McGinty stretches the calves. You wonder if that's the kind of pre-cramping feeling that you get. Also getting some attention. Looks like Cam Dolan.
Dolan, number 4, 6'6", 250-pounder, out of Fort Myers, Florida. Another one of those Life University All-Americans on this team.
And there's the journeyman, Chris Bauman. A lot of these Eagles take kind of the unorthodox path to get onto this team, and Chris Bowman is one of them. Bowman now playing in Santa Monica, but he's from Steamboat Springs in Colorado. Just played in the mountains there, played, you know, in the mountains during the winter, doing some snowboarding, some skiing, and then decided that he really wanted to take a shot at high-level rugby. Moved to Randwick in Australia, played some rugby down there, honed his craft as a prop, and now he's able to play. He was on one of those bubble guys throughout the summer. And besides the best mustache on the team, really brings a bit of an edge. He's got a bit of an attitude that he plays with. You got to admire somebody who's worked that hard to get where he is. Chris Bowman wearing the number 18 jersey for the United States.
Line out, such a key with the U.S. turning it over on their line out and changing the whole complexion of this second half when they were within striking distance of taking the lead from Australia. Since then, the Aussies with the two tries and the kicks for two more points afterward.
Great turnover by the United States.
And the U.S. now, can they get some momentum going once again and get a second win? And Guenya has played a tough game so far.
I don't know if Danny Barrett's been working on the bounce pass, but he seemed to throw one there to Nguyenya.
And the U.S. turns it back over.
Great tackle there by Sean McMahon.
McMahon, number 7, with the hard hit. The 21-year-old who had a great season last year, Super Rugby Rookie of the Year. That was a big hit to get the ball.
And offsides against the Australians. That's Lou Stanfill has checked in as a replacement lock.
Stanfield, one of the veterans on this team, getting ready to go play in his third World Cup for the U.S. in a matter of weeks. And Olive Khalifi also coming in. Some changes now as the U.S. able to use some more players here. Well, and this one goes into touch.
I like that move by Tolkien. I like using the bench. You got to these days. Just it's so hard to stay on the field for 80 minutes, especially if you're in the forward pack. What these guys are doing on the ground, it's mind-boggling. And if you're viewing at home and you're curious about what's going on, here's my suggestion: pick one guy, one number, and just watch him move around the field. See him stick his head into contact, but stay on that same guy, and it'll give you a reflection of what rugby players really do.
And the U.S. trying to make a move here. This would be huge for them to get something on the board. McGinty. Nothing there in the middle.
Australians coming up really quickly and holding on to the ball. United States, a turnover. Looked like Kelly went in with the ball and couldn't recycle it. Australians there to contest for it. You gotta let go of the ball in the tackle. There's a few fundamental elements, Kent. It's tackler has to release the tackle player. Tackle player releases the ball so that both teams can compete for it. Both teams send players to compete for it. A ruck is then formed.
There you look at Bernard Foley. He's done a nice job, as he usually does. Had a big year last year. Great score for this Australian team. Handles their kicks. Here's coming up in 2 weeks. The United States will open play against Samoa.
They will, and that's out of the gates. That's the most important match, and every team will say that about their World Cup campaign, but if the United States is going to achieve its goals of winning 2 matches or even advancing by winning 3, Samoa, they have to win it.
Universal Sports will be your home for World Cup rugby, and then the semifinals and finals will take place at NBC, and there you see the action really heating up now. Exchange of punches and some pushes in there. More pushing than punching.
I'm telling you that it better be pushes, because if somebody throws a punch on that field, it is an automatic suspension. It'll be reviewed by a citation official after the game. He's going to take a DVD of this game and see if there's any foul play.
That was John Quill, number 20 for the U.S. in the mix. Several involved.
Yeah, one of those things where everybody gets involved, and that's just one of those things that happens in a rugby match, kind of like hockey. One guy goes in, everybody kind of has his back.
Well, let's take a look there at how the pushing started. Well, take a pick there, who you think started pushing. I don't know, you counting that as a punch or not? I wouldn't say it was a great punch, but it did have the mannerisms of what you would say a guy attempting to throw a punch.
Well, you from some of these guys, you better hope not. You know, sometimes what the ref says is, you know, both teams guilty of kind of stirring the pot. Everyone's a little agitated. He'll bring both captains over. And what Lou Stanfield's upset about there is they want to be able to take that ball and be and use it as a quick penalty. And you're not allowed to hold the ball. That makes rugby players bristle. When it's their ball and you're holding it, they want it back. They don't want you touching it.
And here how the scrum comes. The U.S. moving with it. Ngwenya has it knocked away from him.
Well, and a chance on the corner there. Ngwenya should have had that ball. Barrett looked like he was drifting a defender straight into Ngwenya. He's got to step off his outside foot and make that defender stay honest, try to free a little space up on the corner for Ngwenya. Instead, he drifts out. He throws a ball to Ngwenya. Maybe Z Ngwenya doesn't expect it and knocks it on. Nevertheless, he should have had that ball. And we see what happens with those mental errors that manifest themselves as these physical errors, the knock-ons, the bad passes. And once again, Australia with the ball. And they've been playing great territory in this second half, really kind of making the United States pay for their mistakes.
They already paid big, didn't they, on the line-out, the U.S. losing that and losing a chance to take the lead. They were trailing 14-10 starting this second half. It's been all Australia on the scoreboard here.
Well, and then the next drive, same thing happened. Up the territory all the way down. Australians march with a couple of penalties, a couple of kicks to the corner, a line out, success. Over the line they go. And when the U.S. looks at this tape of the first 20 minutes of the second half, what they're going to see is perhaps they're the ones who are a little bit on the back foot. They don't have the intensity that matched that first half.
Guinea puts it in. Great shot there. You can see what a scrum looks like up close. And there we have another whistle. For Australia, they've got a test, especially in that first half from the United States. What would it mean for the Americans right now, Brian, to get something, get at least one more score on the board here, not be shut out in the second half?
Well, I think it would mean a lot, and plain and simple. They've talked about how they want to execute. They've talked about the belief that they have in their systems and how they can put points on the board. We saw that in the first half with an exciting breakaway and an overlap on the corner with Ngwenya finishing to Petrie, but they've got to get some points and not be shut out in the second half. I think if they are, they'd be tremendously disappointed.
And the U.S. turning it around and taking the ball back. Here come the Americans. Maybe some second wind here.
It's a great ball to Seamus Kelly. It's got to be caught. Instead, it's knocked on. Kelly's got to bring that ball in. And sometimes that's what separates the best in the world from the up-and-comers. Those balls have to be caught. Look, everyone's going to make mistakes. We saw Australia faltering in the first half, coughing up a lot of balls. But McGinty does a great job to pass this ball out of the tackle. And that's right through the hands of Kelly. He knows it, too. I mean, that's not a surprise to anybody watching this. Kelly's got to bring that ball in. He'll be the first to tell you that.
Seamus Kelly out of Queens, New York, went to the University of California and won two national championships, four-time All-American.
And played under Mike Tolkien at Xavier before he went to Cal. So there's a bit of a Xavier connection. If you look at Petrie, you look at Seamus Kelly.
Xavier is a powerhouse. You look at Cal, you look at LifeU, New York Athletic Club.
There's some really great programs, putting some national team players on the pitch.
Once again, the Aussies on the move in U.S. territory. They try to go outside. Nice open hit. Once again, coming in Quinya.
That's Quinn Cooper in wearing the number 22 jersey.
John Quill makes a nice tackle. They'll work it out and try to come back inside. See if they can get anything going there. And once again brought down. Let's check in with Tracy on the sideline.
Well, Coach Mike Gacheka is known as a taskmaster.
The U.S. has it back. It's A.J. McGinty on a breakaway. One man to bring him down.
That's actually, it's Wiles. He's got Bauman on the outside.
Yes. And can the U.S. get it in? What a turnaround it would be for them.
Well, the energy of this entire stadium has just been turned up a couple of notches, Kenny. The United States got to get points. We talked about it before. You can't just bang on the door. You've got to kick it down.
The crowd trying to encourage them. Smash Mouth trying to move the pile.
Then Danny Barrett on the side. You can tell he wants to will that ball across the line. He's marshaling the forwards. Petrie getting the yellow jerseys out of the way. Penalty advantage coming to the United States.
The U.S. trying for their first points of the second half.
Ball available there for Mike Petrie. Andrew Duratalo. It's going to go back to a penalty advantage on the 5-meter line.
Is how it all started. Great defense, forcing a turnover. And moving in was the captain, Chris Wiles.
Well, you can see the speed of Joe Tamani. And Tamani just gets the shirt tail of Chris Wiles. Bauman, a great line, but certainly not the speed to finish. And U.S. knocking on the door. They'll go to the lineout. Expect Phil Teal to try to throw a dart here. And a drive coming from this U.S. pack. And I tell you what, you want to talk about confidence going into a World Cup. If the United States can take this ball out of the lineout and drive it across the goal line, it'll do wonders for their chances in London. But
it's turned it over. Another bad break on a lineout and a turnover. And here comes Australia running. Australia with numbers. And the Aussies are going to turn this around just like that. Moving in with the score currently Beal. And oh, how many times can it happen to the U.S. twice tonight on lineouts, major turnovers?
Well, there will be nightmares in the forward pack for this U.S. team when execution is critical. They've squandered an opportunity.
And the veteran, Kurt Beal, taking it in.
Here's the lineout from the beginning of the second half. Ball goes drifting forward. That would start.
Two plays, 21 points has been the difference. And you see Beal, who's very much respected. Been a veteran player, and he gets his first try tonight. But the U.S. trailing 14-10 starting this second half. Just a little under 10 minutes to go now in this. And Australia just blowing it open, taking advantage of U.S. turnovers. And, Brian, as you talked about earlier, when it comes in, and this would have been the biggest upset in USA history to pull this off, you can't make any, but you have to play the Villanova against Georgetown basketball game for anybody who remembers in 85. Pretty close to perfect.
Yeah. Well, look, it's not about not making mistakes. Both teams know that when you play hard, you make mistakes, and that's just the way it goes down. But some of the set pieces, some of the mistakes that the U.S. has made are critical mistakes.
At the worst possible time.
They're absolute must-haves. And you see Australia, you know, what makes them number two in the world is they'll take one of the mistakes that you make and they'll punish you by putting 7 points on the board. And that's exactly what happens here. But this ball started on the 5-meter line outside of the Australian goal line, should have been safely in the hands of the U.S. forward pack and possibly driven across the line.
So twice, America will have to think what might have been. Getting it down to 2 meters, seeing it go the opposite way. 6 USA turnovers here in the second half, 2 for Australia. And the 6 for the U.S., 3 of those leading to direct scores.
Well, you have to if you're the U.S., you have to develop a little bit of grit now. You got to play on an edge and try to finish off this game. You got 10 minutes left in this contest. You got to try to make something happen. You want to finish on a positive note. That could have been the positive note after the Wiles interception and almost try. So Teal now with another throw. You know, and it gets in the mind of a hooker. He's the one throwing the ball in. For Teal, for his confidence, for the continuity of his game, this is an important throw, regardless of the scoreline.
Shalom Sunuliola, number 22, in the lineup once again for the U.S. Teal with the lineout.
And if only that was the lineout from several minutes ago.
Because the 25,000 plus here were ready to erupt. And the momentum could have taken a whole new swing. But then that's been the case twice tonight for the U.S. inside the 2-meter mark. You could talked about the great camp they had in July, the three wins they had against the Canadian team, feeling that this is the year in 2 weeks when they go to the World Cup, they can make it out of pool play. You think that is possible, or is that wishful thinking on their part?
I think it's absolutely possible. Now, look at the scoreline here. You got a 25-point spread, but at the same time, you think about the critical mistakes that the U.S. made when they had scoring opportunities. And if you can right those mistakes, then they're right in it against Australia. Maybe they don't come away with a victory, but they're close. They got to take the positives away from this, and that's been the talk in camp all week. I think they've allowed for the very distinct possibility that Australia was going to win this game, but they also talked about what they could have to take away. And to take away from it, can they play their pattern? Could they compete for the ball? Could they get in the face of the Australians? And could they put some points on the board? And the answer to all of that is yes, but they still have a long way to go. They need to pour it on against Samoa. They get them first out of the pool in a couple weeks in Brighton. And then if they win that game, then the confidence is going to be swelling in the U.S. camp. Penalty advantage at the scrum again. Another concern area for the Eagles. Oh, that's a great take by Tomani.
And once again, Australia getting close to a try. And did they get in?
Wade Cooper goes across the line. And
Tomani setting it up. Did Cooper get it across?
Now we're going to go to the TMO for the first time, Kenny. TMO, the television match official referee, has a set of officials upstairs looking at a bank of monitors. They'll get some replays to take a look at. The question is, did Quade Cooper ground the ball on the line or over the line, or was he held up? Now it looks like he's a clear grounding there.
Obviously, Joe Tomani, number 14, leaping up, who helped initiate that play.
Yeah,
I believe so.
Look at the hands of Cooper, and as the tape rolls forward, you see him right there. Ball is grounded, and the pressure is applied by the Australian. That's going to be a try.
And another look to Quade Cooper. He's battled injuries the last couple of years, limited his playing time, but was he able to get across?
The play from the Australians there, the real critical piece was they brought the blindside wing. And Joe Tomani comes in and takes the ball. There's a natural overlap. If the U.S. doesn't slide across in defense, you have more people in the back line.
And those are the first points in this second half from Australia that was not a direct result of a U.S. turnover.
They're going to get some breaks, Australia.
The kick is good. Let's check in with Tracy.
I'm with AJ McGinty down here on the bench. You've just come off the field. You've scored a couple of points. Your thoughts on your play and the play of your teammates?
I thought we started quite slow, let them in the game. They got two easy tries. But slowly in that first half, we worked our way back into them and played quite well, earned a good try. They're just very clinical. Like, if you kick the ball away sloppy to them, they punish you. And the pace of the game has just been stepped up again, and we've kind of been tired and starting to make a few errors. So we've been sort of just too many mistakes here.
You must be pleased with some of the ground you've made against this Australian team.
Yeah, like, it was always going to be a tough game, always a new challenge for us. Like, it's the games we've had building up this haven't been as strong. The teams have been strong, but not a number two in the world. So it was always going to be a step up. And I thought we rose that. We played well for 40 minutes, but just we're starting to get tired and make a lot of mistakes. So
thanks, AJ.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
The captain with it, Chris Wiles. U.S. trying to get some points on the board. They had 10 at intermission, and that's where it stood now with just around 4 minutes to go in this match. And for the Australians, they took advantage of the turnovers. You see, 28 points here in the second half. Those last seven were the first time they'd scored that wasn't a direct result of one of the six U.S. turnovers in this second half.
Referee having a discussion with the AR, the assistant referee, saw something, stuck his flag out.
And if you're not even familiar with rugby, one thing universal in all sports, turnovers will punish you as any game goes along.
But I think AJ McGinty's words were spot on. And we talked about it at the beginning of the game. The United States is going to be pushed and challenged by the pace of the Australian game. And you just heard him say they've upped the pace, they've increased the tempo, and we are tired. And that's exactly what you're seeing on the field.
September 18th on Universal Sports, 2015 World Cup begins from England.
And Bernard Foley will find the touchline and really slow the tempo now. And with the victory firmly in hand, they're just going to look to leak the last 3.5 minutes off the clock.
There you see Australia, number two in the world. But as you pointed out, Brian, it's no break being number two in the world in that pool.
No, you know, England at home with the World Cup. The Welsh, very dangerous, although today a bad break when they played Italy, lost Lee Halfpenny and Reese Webb. They were stretchered off of the field, and you want to talk about panic waves for head coach Warren Gatland. They've already got the toughest pool in the tournament, and two of their best players potentially looking at injuries. Hopefully those two will be all right.
Well, it's been exciting for the Australians to be here. They talked about getting to play in Soldier Field. They watched the New Zealand game last year. They know the history here and the history of college football that is Notre Dame. So they began their week last week actually in South Bend. I don't know. Would that be like try Jesus instead of touchdown? I don't know. Here they are, the Aussies, on the South Bend campus. Coaches talking like coaches talk. They work out a different kind of ball being used there. But look, that football looks familiar, doesn't it? That's not a rugby ball. And they're actually going back to South Bend. Irish, of course, playing tonight, opening their season against the Longhorns of Texas.
And Matt Gitto throwing that football. Looks like he needs to continue throwing rugby balls underhanded.
So what'd you say? They told you they're going to go over and put the pads on next week.
Yeah, some of them, I think they want to put shoulder pads on, see what it's like.
They're going back over to Notre Dame and spend another few days before getting ready to go to England. Right now, they're trying to get back in for a score, and they do.
And this is just the Australians have stretched the fitness and the capacity of this Eagle team to stay on the field.
And another line-out turnover for the U.S. That has been the... That they've accounted for all but one score for the Aussies here in the second half, but been turnovers by the U.S.
Justin Fitzpatrick not happy with these lineouts. And that's Tekeli Nayaravaro. Makes his way onto the field.
Nayaravaro coming in, getting in on the act. Cooper also with the score coming in here in the second half. The Australians enjoying the visit here to Chicago, even though it has been a little warm and humid tonight. Meekum Auctions from Houston coming up next here on NBCSN. And this has been a a fun night of rugby for the 25,000 plus here and those watching on NBCSN. And certainly a great first half for the Americans. Very energized, very aggressive, maybe a little overly so at times, but they were within 4 points at intermission of the second best team of the world.
Well, they did get stretched, but you know, Kenny, they did put some phases together. They were able to score a nice try against Australia. We saw them show up with the shoulders in the first half and match the Australians and perhaps actually surpass them in their physicality. Now the question is, can they take this and stretch it into a two-half game when they get to the World Cup? They'll need to do it against Samoa. Samoa won't pose as big a risk as these Australians. You have to have a little bit of amnesia when you play this game. You got to forget about the bad stuff you've done, take the positives away, learn from your mistakes, and then just move on.
Well, they needed to play close to perfect. Always a challenge on any level, and the turnovers simply wiped out the U.S. tonight. For anybody that just tuned in and saw that score, they would have thought, oh, kind of like New Zealand again. It was far from it in the first half, and into the start of the second half it was 14-10 Australia. But then the U.S. with seven big turnovers here, leading to every score except one for the Aussies here in the second half.
I love when you look around the stands that so many people have stuck around until the end of this match, Kenny, and the score line. Really, it's been a fait accompli for a long time. But they want to see these Wallabies play. It's so rare to get a chance to see one of the top couple of nations in the world play rugby here on home soil, especially in this venue.
It's been a real treat for fans here in the Chicago area, seeing New Zealand, number one in the world last November, and now seeing number two Australia coming in here off that victory against New Zealand, and certainly going into the World Cup, even though they're in a difficult pool, as one of the teams to beat. The Aussies hoping to go away with their third World Cup championship. The U.S. hoping to get out of pool play for the first time, and maybe the Americans can remember all the good things that we're doing in the first half of this game.
I'll tell you what, Sean McMahon, when we talked to him earlier, said that he really wanted to cement a place for himself in this squad on the bench during the tight games of the World Cup. And I like the way this number seven's played. Adds a new dimension. I think he just gets around the field as well as a Michael Hooper or David Pocock type. A different dimension, a little bit lankier than a Pocock. But I tell you what, he's definitely been my man of the match for Australia.
And for the U.S., some big hits early. Good defense, I thought, in the first half. Nice open field tackles.
Yeah, and, you know, and the bench a little bit thin for the Eagles. Once they start going to the next eight players after their first 15, there's some concerns, especially on an international level. World Cups are won by teams with deep benches. That means when you bring someone in, you don't lose a thing from that player coming on as a replacement. And you can't replace a Chris Wiles on the U.S. team. You can't replace an Aaron Fry on this team. You got to get quality minutes, not only out of this first 15, but the people who come off the bench have to step up. Well, great occasion for U.S. rugby, as you said, Kenny, to have Australia on home soil before a World Cup.
It is huge for both programs. Australians excited to be here. As we said, they really enjoyed hanging around Notre Dame's football stadium as well.
And a knock on, another unforced error. Seamus Kelly can't find the handle. Will Genia boots it into touch, and that is the end of this match.
Australia shutting out the U.S. in the second half. It was 14-10 at intermission. All Australia in the second half, scoring all but one of their tries on turnovers by the U.S. At one time early in the second half, the U.S. had a chance to take the lead 17-14 inside the 2 meters, but they turned it over. Australia drove it all the way the other direction and scored, and that completely changed the complexion of the second half. And the number two team in the world, as expected, comes away with a big win here.
We saw a pretty adventurous half by the Australians in the first 40 minutes. They didn't try to kick any penalties. They were always going for tries. And they were a little bit more composed, more territory-oriented in the second half. They really went back to the set piece, put the United States under some pressure in the scrums. And then the U.S. lineouts fell apart, and that was really the difference. They gave Australia ball. They turn that ball into territory. That's why they're number two in the world, why they're one of the favorites going into this World Cup, Kenny.
Makem Anschutz, Houston, coming up next year on NBCSN. And for the U.S., getting ready now with their goal of getting out of pool play. A little frustrating tonight with that second half performance and those turnovers. And you heard earlier on, AJ McGinty said they got a little tired. Australia took advantage of the turnovers and really changed the pace in this second half of play. For the Aussies, well, they have won World Cups in 91 and 99. They were runners up in 2003. After that win over the number one All Blacks of New Zealand, they have hopes that they can do it once again. Let's go down now to Tracy.
James, your thoughts on this win for Australia?
Oh, look, it was a good win. We came here to win the game. We ended up doing that. It proves how good the Eagles are. They came out in that first half and really played some really great rugby. So, look, they're going to go far into the World Cup, and, credit to them.
You talked about the physicality of the Eagles coming into this game. They didn't disappoint.
No, they didn't. I think both teams showed physicality. I think, it was a very hot and humid game out here, and the weather was really tricky. So for us to just come away with the win, we were happy with that and build into the World Cup from here.
Best of luck on your quest for the world title.
Yeah, cheers. Thanks. Bye.
All right, thanks, Tracy. James Slipper and company coming away with the win. 47-10. We'll have more when we come back to International Rugby Classic, presented by Estella's. Big second half for number two Aussies to blow it open. We'll talk more about it. Stay with us.